Hey guys, what's up? I just recorded. This is my second time trying to record this video, but it was a bit long, and I don't like doing long videos, believe it or not. This one was like 28 minutes, and I uploaded the video, and I was like, that's way too long. I can just get to the point. I want to talk about relationships and whether they be sexual, non-sexual, or whatever. You guys know I'm gay. You guys know I'm HIV positive. You guys know I've battled cancer 5 times. You know about the sickle cell. You know about all of that. What some of you may not know is that I've been in 2 long-term relationships. The first one was 4 years, and the next one was 15 years. And I am still the very best of friends with both of those guys. Even the guy who I contracted HIV from, there was a friendship, a trust there prior to the infection. And it took a while for me to get past it, but I did. Will we be friends like we were? No. Will we be as close as I thought we were? No. Do I care about what happens to this person? Yeah. Do I speak to this person? Yeah. Did it take me a little while to speak to this person? Absolutely. There was a period where I just wanted to take a machete and chop his head off. There was definitely the period where I was angry and upset that someone would lie to me in such a way. Having said all of that, in my 2 long-term relationships, when problems came up, when we had disagreements, they were disagreements about things that people have disagreements about. Bills. Baby, did you just drink the milk and not replace it? Did you just leave a swig of milk here? Did you just fart? Come on, did you forget to take out the trash? It was stuff like that. There was never an argument or a disagreement. Well, there weren't that many arguments, I can honestly say, in the first 2, and actually all 3, there were not that many arguments, and if there were arguments, they were settled within the hour, within a very short time period of them starting. They were settled, and we got past it. But there was never an issue that came up that I could say was a gay issue, was something that is inherent to gay people. So when I hear black women say things like, oh, that's because you're gay. You're gay. And when I say black women, please don't take that to mean all black women say that, because my mother would never say anything like that. My close circle of black friends would never say something like that because they don't think that way. That's not who they are. It's not a part of their character. It's not in their genetic makeup. So don't think that I am saying all black women say this, because that's not what I'm saying. But for me, I have only heard this statement when it is said to me or in my company. It has always come from a black woman. And I don't know what it is, if it's a way of trying to cut somebody down or make somebody feel less than, make somebody feel bad, if it's your way of inserting your dominance and your power, or somehow showing me or the person you've said that to that you are superior to them, that's not what it is for me. For me, what it does, it reveals to me just how ignorant you are. Within the past month, I've heard that said to me at least 10 times. Within the past 24 hours, I've heard it 3 times, yesterday and twice today. And it was in the context of dating, relationships, black men. And whenever I chimed in, it's like, oh, you don't know, you're gay. It's different for gay people. I'm sorry, it's not. There's no such thing as a gay bill from BMW. There's no such thing as a gay mortgage. There's no such thing as gay milk. But relationship problems are relationship problems. And gay people have the exact same problems that straight people have. And don't try to pretend for 1 minute that you don't take it up the ass, black women. Some of you take it up the ass more than gay men. So cut that shit out. It's ignorant. It's stupid. It's pathetic. It makes you look dumb. It makes you sound angry, bitter, and mad. And by attacking me or any other gay person, you think that makes you look better? It doesn't. It really doesn't. Today the conversation came up after, today I went to my great uncle's funeral. He died last Saturday, the day of my art show, was his 100th birthday. And I had the chance to speak to him earlier in the morning. And about maybe, I don't know, 30, 45 minutes, maybe an hour after I had the chance to speak to him, my cousin calls and tells me that he had passed. And it just kind of like put me in a space. And I didn't know what I was going to do, if I was going to attend my event or if I should go be over with my cousins and my great aunt. And I remember calling and speaking to my great aunt, and she just said, what are you going to come for? You're not going to make him come back. He's not going to come back to life. You have an event to do. And after that, I spoke with my friend Tabitha, and she just helped me put a lot of things into perspective. So I went ahead and attended my event that I had been working on for 7 months. And I went to celebrate my life, the life of people who are living with HIV, as well as my uncle's life, 100 years. That's wisdom and knowledge and power that you're not going to get from a textbook, that you're not going to get from shooting the shit with somebody. That's wisdom, knowledge, and power that is rare. And it's the type of wisdom, knowledge, and power that you have to be present for. And I am so glad that I was present for the wisdom, knowledge, and power and courage and strength that my uncle bestowed upon me. Just such an amazing life. And since we're on the subject of death, this is the third death in my family, and it's the third death of a great one, meaning a great aunt or an uncle, and their ages were 93, 96, and 100 years old. Imagine living that long. Imagine that. But I said all that to say this. So today, after the funeral, and this is the first time I've ever attended a funeral in someone's home. My aunt didn't want it at a church. She didn't want a whole bunch of people. She just wanted family and his close friends. And so they did it at their home in View Park here in Los Angeles, which is an affluent, predominantly black area here in Los Angeles. And once we got back from taking the body to the cemetery, we were just sitting around, a bunch of us. We were talking about relationships and stuff, and one of my female cousins, who I think she lives in Texas, well, she grew up here until she was about 13, and then she moved to Texas, and I think she's been living back here for about 4 months. And we just started talking about relationships, the dating pool, and I kept hearing this reoccurring thing, and this reoccurring theme, and I hear this a lot about people, from people who have moved here to Los Angeles. I hear them say how fake, phony, and shallow, and superficial LA people are, but when you inquire as to where they hang out, who they hang out with, they're doing the whole Hollywood thing. And when I say Hollywood, I mean they're doing the Hollywood clubs, they're doing the Hollywood thing, they're doing the BET bullshit, they're doing all the stuff to try to be in the limelight. They want to date producers, rappers, singers, they want somebody with money. You gotta have this, you gotta, the whole Hollywood plastic thing. And if I actually ran in those circles, I can see where that would lead one to believe that LA is superficial and plastic. Well, not all of us here are that way. There is definitely that element here, and there are definitely some trifling black men here, but there is a Hollywood element and trifling black men everywhere. It is not something that is exclusive to Los Angeles, and anybody who believes that is just fucking delusional. Anybody who moves to a city to get away from the so-called bad area they came from, to move here to complain about the area in which they now live, what leads me to believe it is not the area, it's the person. It's the person doing the complaining. There's a common denominator, and the common denominator is the person doing all the complaining. It's like shopping at a store that always has rotten vegetables and rotten fruit, but you keep going there to shop thinking that you are going to get vegetables that come from Gelson's or Whole Foods, Trader Joe's. It's like shopping at Walmart thinking you're going to find the same selection that you're finding at Neiman Marcus, Saks Fifth Avenue, Jones of New York, Jessa McClintock. That's just not going to happen. I know Walmart would lead you to believe that, but that's just not the way things are. So whose fault is it that if every time you get spoiled fruit, you continue to go to that same nasty-ass market that sold you the same fruit? Whose fault is it that you end up being with a trifling black man, but you still keep going to the same area where you got the last trifling black man? And it's not the trifling black man's problem. You're the one opening up your legs. You're the one unzipping your pants. Because this applies to guys, too. Because I hear guys say this as well. Trifling black women. You go to the same area. You're shopping in the same store where those trifling people hang together. Birds of a feather flock together. I just don't get that. I take offense to people saying LA is this way. Well, if LA is that way, get the fuck out of here. That's one less car on our freeway, one less brake light, one less angry person who is so bitter and jaded towards Los Angeles. Get the fuck out of here. I'm getting sidetracked. What pisses me off is when I hear black women say, "Oh, you don't know, you're gay." As if relationships are somehow different when you're gay. The problems are the same. A problem is a problem is a problem is a problem is a problem. Baby, did you not take the dog out? Baby, this bill was due last week. Baby, could you not spend no more money? Did you really need to go buy those shoes? It's not, baby, did you really have to go get those gay underwear? It's not, honey, did you really need to go buy that gay car? Did you really need to go to that gay church? Would you stop having your gay friends come around here? That's bullshit. That's a cop-out. And the only thing, when I hear that, what I hear is ignorance and your own insecurities toward yourself. What I hear is your own self-doubt, your own self-worth or lack thereof coming to the surface. So today when my cousin said it, she happened to say it, my other cousins were there, and Jeffrey has been in his relationship with his boyfriend for 32 years. And he just looks at her and he's like, what's a gay relationship? He was just like, what's a gay problem in a relationship? He goes, you think we go to the store and buy gay milk? Do you think we pay gay bills? He goes, our bills are the same. Our dollars don't say fag dollars or lesbian dollars, dyke dollars, or anything else. It says in God we trust, just like yours. So how is it different? I just don't get that. I don't understand where this comes from, and where are these sister girl conventions, and would you guys stop having them? All black men are not trifling. All black men are not gay or date outside their race. And if they are dating outside their race, maybe it's because they ran into too many black women like you. Maybe because they ran into too many fucked up, jaded ass, gold digging sisters like you. Let's just call it what it is. And black men, do me a favor. Whether you sticking and moving with dudes or sticking and moving with women, be honest. Tell whoever it is you sticking it to or whoever you getting it from what it is up front. Be honest. Be honest. And black women, stop saying this bullshit, oh, that's because you're gay. That's like me saying that's because you wear a weave. That's like a white person saying, oh, that's because you grew up in the ghetto. You wouldn't like that. You wouldn't like a white person saying to you, oh, you're not going to understand this conversation, Kizzy, because it's a little bit too educated for you, Kizzy. You wouldn't like that bullshit, but it's okay for you to do it to your own. And for any black woman who has ever said to me, that's because you're gay, Lewis, or that's because you're gay, Kenji, those are the same black women that will call me faggot. Those are the same black women that will just blast my HIV status out to anybody without giving a fuck. Those are the same black women who are upset with black men who have done nothing to them. And it has nothing to do with black men. It has everything to do with you. Sometimes we need to get out of this need to be right, this wanting to argue, this wanting to be upset, this wanting to be soul sister girl number one, I don't need a man type bullshit, and shut the fuck up and start paying attention to all the bullshit that you create, all the kaflama, confusion and drama that you create. Maybe there aren't any black men because you have a fucked up attitude, or you bring to the table this fucking huge ass ego, or all this baggage from the last brother that did you wrong. But I'm a firm believer, people can only do to you what you allow them to do. So if your last brother did you wrong, how long did you put up with it? And if you put up with it for a second longer than when you realize this brother was no good, that's your own fucking fault. That's not that brother's fault. That's your fault. Stop blaming black men for everything. Stop saying black men are the root of your problems. You're the root of your problem. That's all there is to it. Stop blaming cities. Stop blaming people, places, and things for your fucked up behavior, your fucked up attitude. There is no such thing as, oh, you're gay. You won't understand this. You're gay. Come on. If anybody's gonna understand it, it's going to be a gay person. if you really want to put it like that, if anybody's going to understand you, it's going to be a gay person. Because we got so much shit that we got to deal with, including the bullshit you give us like this. There was a saying, and I can't remember who said it, but I remember my Nana said it once. We were somewhere, I think we were at a church, and Nana was my great-grandmother. We were at a church, and the pastor said something, and my Nana said, "It is far better for people to think of you as a fool than to open your mouth and remove all doubt." Sometimes we need to just shut the fuck up and take ownership of our role in, take ownership of our role in every situation that we encounter. Because what we bring to the table is what we get out of it. Period. End of discussion. I got 99 problems, but gay ain't one.